Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Deborah Cobray.
So are you ready to get into the book tonight? If you've got your Bibles, we're going to be in a lot of places, and see if I can find what I wanted to do this. Okay, I wanted to read something to you because I read this in my Christology class, and I've read it to you before, but I think one of the things about looking at the end times that is so important, it's absolutely mandatory, is that when we open the book of Revelation, there is a promise and there is a blessing, and God says, blessed is he who reads aloud the words of this book. There are 7 blessings in the book of Revelation, and the first one is found in chapter 1. And it is the revelation of Jesus Christ to his church. So it's a revelation of who Jesus is. We're going to see him bigger than he's ever been. And it's also a revelation that he gives to his church of what's going to happen in the end times. Because his disciples asked him. And John is on the island of Patmos, and he's there being persecuted. He's imprisoned on that island, and there he receives a revelation of Jesus Christ. And so for me, the most important thing is, in my little piece of this end times series, is that we see Jesus. Because without seeing him, nothing else makes any sense. And so I wanted to read this to you because from the beginning of this book to the end of it, from Genesis to Revelation, this book is about one thing and one thing only, and his name is Jesus. All prophecy, the spirit of prophecy, is the testimony of Jesus, the angel told John when he tried to worship him. And he said, don't worship me. I am a fellow servant. Worship God. Worship Jesus. And I wanted to read this to you because I think it's a pretty amazing thought. So are you ready? Having become man, God the Son will never cease to be man. Even in heaven and through all eternity, he will be God in the flesh, albeit glorified flesh. The humanity that he has assumed on earth, he has taken to heaven. There is no longer a penalized, suffering humanity, but a human body irradiated with the glory of God. The eternal Logos will forever know in himself the joy of the redeemed as well as the triumph of the Redeemer. He will live forever in 2 natures. The implications of this for our planet and its people are enormous. It means that there is a human being on the throne of the universe. In the place of supreme and central significance for all creation, there is a man, a member of and the head of the human race. Science has taught us something of the vastness of the created universe, but because of its alienation from God and its consequent deficit understanding of humankind, as it should be, our society has felt shrunken and lost and insignificant in a vast cosmos. But it is in the teaching and life and redeeming work of Jesus Christ that we discover reconciled man's true significance and real destiny. It was not to an angelic race that God was born, but into the people of this inconspicuous planet. It is not an angelic nature that he now inhabits and lives through at the Father's right hand, but a human one. Go to the spiritual heart of this created universe, and there you will find a man. Go to the place where angels bow who never fell, and there you will find a man. Go to the very center of the manifested glory of the invisible God, and you will find a man. True human nature, one of your own race, mediating the glory of God. What a thought. And I guess my question is, Lord, as David wrote in Psalm chapter 2, who are we, or Psalm 8, who are we that you would be mindful of us? Who are we that God would step out of eternity and clothe himself in flesh, become the kinsman redeemer, the blood relative, the last Adam that would walk this human experience and come and show us the way to what we are supposed to be, how we were created to be, and what we were supposed to be like? You and I are human beings made in the image of God. We are being. We are becoming and we are being. That's what a human being is. And so here we are at the end times and looking at this vast book of Revelation and the Word of God and the New Testament. And tonight will be a little bit in the book of Daniel, but not much, just a mention of it. And what I want to say more than anything else to you tonight is this: none of it will make sense or mean anything to us if self and me is at the very center of my inquiry. What about me, God? What's going to happen? Tell us what it's like to be like, because I believe there is so much speculation. And it's almost like a gossip of the end times. And God, I think, has a far greater picture for you and I. Not trying to figure every detail out in every linear note and chapter and page in this book. But I believe God has a destiny and a plan. And we as his people, as his born again, redeemed and reconciled and restored humanity, that he has a plan in the 21st century for you and I to live out our faith and this amazing life that he's given us in the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our guarantee and as our ring, our engagement ring, and the one who indwells us, the Spirit of grace, the Spirit of Jesus Christ himself. The one who raised Jesus from the dead, as he indwells these fleshly bodies that house our eternal spirits. God has a plan and a purpose for every single one of us in this room to fulfill our destinies. And if he should tarry, to come home. And death will claim us in the natural. But we have already passed from death into life. And we will be more alive than we've ever been. There will only be one generation that will not touch death and not taste it. And that will be the generation that will be raptured. And tonight we're going to look at the rapture. Are you interested? So here we go. Last week we looked at the signs of his coming. Tonight I want to give you another view of another view. As we said last week, the only thing that I was taught as a Christian growing up in an evangelical community, a beautiful community, I thank God for my mother, my pastor, Pastor Norris, who's in heaven now, and how they loved me and taught me the word of God. I thank God that God forgave me and welcomed me back after I had gone astray for 10 years and absolutely rebelled into foolishness and absolute sin. And all I was taught as a child through those years that I lived in church, and I lived in church because my mother happened to have been the secretary of the pastor, and so I was at every service. My dad wasn't saved, but my mom was saved, and she made us kids. She drug us to church. I was drugged from the time I was a little girl. Heavy drugs, absolutely. She drugged me to every service there ever was in that little church, and I thank God she did, because when I rebelled on my own with no excuse but my own foolishness, there was so much of God on the inside of me that when I should have been dead or I should have been arrested or something should have happened to me, there was the keeping power of the grace of God and the goodness of God that wouldn't allow certain things to happen in my life, because he knew that one day I would be here doing what I'm doing now for the last 37 years. So maybe your kids are all screwed up right now, or maybe you're a mess, but take heart, because that's not who you really are, and that's not the end of your beginning. You're just beginning. And here's the thing, is as we look at this book and as we go and as we see these things, I was only taught, and you've only been taught, one thing and one thing only. It's called dispensationalism. Dispensationalism is a theory of revelation. And it was founded in about 1830, and it's been around for about 150 years. Up until that time, the church never heard it and never knew it. And yet in our generation, my generation as a boomer, that's all I ever knew. And it came to the United States when Schofield picked it up and put it in his Bible at the turn of the 20th century, and it's been in the church ever since. So if I am going to show you some things in the Word of God tonight, and you are absolutely attached to your view of the end times because that's all you've heard, I can tell you this, maybe it's right. But what if there's another view? And what if there's other things that are going on that maybe are more important than whether or not everything lines up like ducks in a row? What if God wants to speak to us and he wants to show us some things and bigger things, and he wants our lives to count because he doesn't want us distracted about our theology, whether it's right or wrong, but he wants us to fall in love with Jesus? Because it just seems to me when a wife falls in love with a husband that she'll follow him anywhere. When I know my husband loves me, and he does, and when I met him and I fell in love with him, I'd have gone to the moon and back for that man. If he would have told me, let's go to a desert place, and I hate the desert, I'd have gone, not kicking and screaming. I would have gone because I was absolutely head over heels in love with Jim Cobray, a bride. And the church is the bride of Christ. We are being groomed right now and being educated right now by the Holy Spirit to learn to rule on this planet in the power of God, which is his agape love. Just as Eve had to be like Adam to be his companion, you and I had to have a new nature to be like the one, our bridegroom. And there's a bigger picture here than whether we've got our theology straight on the end times. And I can tell you this right now. No one knows for sure what's going to happen. And the only one that's going to know is the generation that is alive through it. And with hindsight, they'll be able to tell you, yeah, I can see this, and I can see this, and I can see this. But my prayer is that we would see Jesus in this series of end times, and that we would gain understanding about becoming wise as serpents and harmless as doves. So the rapture of the church tonight, another view of another view. Now, last week I told you there was a difference between tribulation and great tribulation. And it's important that we realize this because in the system that we have been taught, in the dispensational system of rapture before there's any trouble and the church going not going through any tribulation at all, Jesus said that in the world you're going to have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. That was John 16:33. But then he differentiates and he talks to us about a great time of testing that's coming upon the whole world. There is going to be a time that is going to be so horrific that if he had not shortened those days, not one flesh, no flesh would be alive and would be able to survive it. And let me read it to you. Matthew 24, looking at verses 21 and 22. For then there will be great tribulation, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time. No, nor shall ever be. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. So tonight, I want to look at what is the rapture? What is a pre-tribulation rapture? What is a mid-rapture? And maybe even look at the end, what is a post-rapture of the church? So are you with me? All right, let's go. I've got a little, I don't know what you would call this, just a little picture. There you go. 7-year concept of tribulation. It's called dispensationalism. That's what you're taught. How many of you have heard end time teaching? And that there's a 7-year tribulation? How many have heard a 7-year tribulation? I will give Dr. Kobernick, this is his words. He challenges his students in eschatology in the Bible College. I'll give $1,000 to anybody that can find the word 7 years in the book of Revelation. Because it's not there. It is not there. Again, it's a theory and a system of theology, a doctrine, which is okay. They may be right. I'm not here to bash anybody. But I am here to say we teach as doctrine the traditions of men, and we need to be careful that we don't overstep what God has not completely shown us. And so the 7-year concept of tribulation says that the church is going to be raptured before the 7 years of great trouble begin. There is 3.5 years where the Antichrist, and next week Dan will be teaching on the Antichrist because he starts off as a spirit, he works into a system, and then he evolves into a man at the end times. And so there will be an Antichrist that will be here. That's clear in the Word of God. There's 3.5 years according to dispensationalism. Now, this is the 7-year concept of tribulation, and it's found in the book of Daniel in chapter 9 of the 70 weeks. So the book of Daniel is what is actually driving this theology. And Daniel's 70 weeks when he went to the Lord and he began to seek the Lord. He sought the Lord for why and when they would be released from captivity. And he began to repent. And Daniel was greatly beloved. And God begins to give Daniel these amazing visions. And he answers his prayer. So according to the 70 weeks in the book of Daniel, in the 9th chapter, there will be 7 years of tribulation. There will be a 7-year time when this being will rise up, and he is part of a demonic trinity, the dragon, Satan, has his antichrist, and his antichrist has his false prophet. So there is a demonic trinity. That is going to happen. We can see it in the book of Revelation. And that there'll be 3.5 years where this demonic antichrist will make a treaty with Israel. And Israel will enter into a covenant with the antichrist. And in 3.5 years, the antichrist will break that treaty, and there will be great, great persecution. And in this theory of dispensationalism, we are told that the church is gone. It's not here. We're raptured out of here. Rapture is the word harpazo, and it's a word that means to be caught up and to be snatched or to be pulled. You're not going to find the word rapture in the Word of God. You're going to find the word, the Greek word harpazo, and we'll look at that in a minute. But in Revelation 1:19, this is what they say. Write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after this. Revelation 2 and 3 are the seven letters to the seven churches, where God is bringing forth letters to seven churches, and these seven churches are seven different time zones through the church history, which I wonder about that. There's holes in this theory, guys, big holes. The scripture that reveals the secret rapture of the church before the opening of the scrolls is Revelation 4:1. Now, this is what they say. I want you to look at this. John has seen Jesus in chapter 1 and 2. Jesus has had seven letters to his seven churches. He has told them what to do. He's told them what's wrong, and he's told them what's right. Only two churches that were not strongly, strongly corrected by the Lord. And that was Sardi, and that was Philadelphia, the Church of Love, and Sardi, which was small and persecuted. All the others, all five churches, they had some very, very major things wrong, and Jesus corrects them because he loves us and he tends the flame of his church. And John sees him holding a candlestick, and he asks him the interpretation of this, and Jesus begins to share with him that the candlestick are the seven churches, and the seven messengers are the seven pastors. He's writing this letter to his churches. And here we see the Lord God Almighty, Jesus Christ, the man seated at the right hand of the Father. He's tending the flame of his church. He bought the church. He's purchased the church. He owns the church. We belong to him. Period. And Jesus will correct and he will fix what's wrong with us. So it's great for you to read those letters because there is correction and there is rebuke and there is wisdom and instruction and description of Jesus in every single one, but time will not permit us to go into that. So chapters 2 and 3 deal with the seven churches. Now we come to chapter 4, and suddenly John is caught up. He hears a voice, and let me read it again. This is where we start the rapture. It says, Revelation 4:1, after these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. And this is where the dispensational theory that we are taught tells us we're gone. We are now raptured, and we are out of the earth, and we are gone. It has already happened. We are in heaven now because John was told in chapter 1, verse 19, the things which are, the things which will take place after this, and the things, for you have seen the things which are, the things which will take place after this, and now we see that they are no longer on the earth. I don't know about you, but I have a problem with that. I have a problem with putting all my ducks in one row, and that the Holy Spirit is gone, the church is gone, and now we are at the throne of God, and we're seeing this vast scene. That's dispensationalism. Why do I have a problem with this? Because dispensationalism, or the interpretation, depicts the church raptured before John sees the throne of God and the Lamb opens the scroll. The church is in heaven with Jesus, and now Israel is left, and the 144,000 Jews, that's a literal number, will evangelize the earth. The dragon, the Antichrist, and the false prophet will wage war against Israel, but first make a covenant with Israel for peace. The latter agreement will be broken for 3.5 years, and then there will be great distress and tribulations such as the world has never seen. Jesus returns with his saints and destroys the Antichrist and false prophet, locks up the dragon in the bottomless pit for a 1,000-year period of time called the millennium. This is all we ever hear. Movies about it, books about it, people have gotten rich on it. Based on just a couple of verses that we're not there any longer. 2 Thessalonians says that there'll be a catching away and that there is one who restrains and that one who restrains will be removed. And they say, that's the Holy Spirit. How can you get saved without the Holy Spirit? How can you say Jesus is Lord if the Holy Spirit isn't there? Because my Bible says no man can say Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Spirit. So I have found in my long life that there are just some little holes in this that I swallowed hook, line, and sinker. Because it was all I was ever taught. So I decided I'm going to study Revelation. And I decided I'm going to listen to a man that I trust in the spirit. His name is Pastor Jack Hafer, Dr. Jack Hafer. Anybody know who he is? Well, he messed me up really bad. Because I found out there was a whole part of the church that didn't buy dispensationalism. Even though that's all we've heard. And that it was only around for 150 years. But the church all the way back didn't even have a clue about dispensationalism. They saw it in a whole different way. And it's called the historical view. And so with your permission, I'm going to share that with you tonight in the rapture. Is that all right? Now, you are completely welcome to believe what you believe as you study the scriptures and the Holy Spirit teaches you. And can I say, I hope dispensationalism is right. I hope it is. But I'm going to believe for the best, but prepare for the worst. Just in case I'm around in some tough times, I don't want to be a part of the great falling away that we saw last week is going to happen for the Antichrist to be revealed. You can't fall away from a place you've not been at. So somewhere, something's going to happen that the church worldwide is going to fall away, a great falling away, before the son of perdition, the Antichrist, that's 2 Thessalonians, is going to be revealed. And as a pastor, I feel strongly by the Holy Spirit that our job is to make disciples of Jesus Christ. And I've seen through the age-long church that there have been people that thought that they were in the tribulation. John thought Nero, I mean, they thought that Nero was the Antichrist. In Rome, you couldn't say Jesus is Lord without being sentenced to death because Caesar was Lord. You see, we have a Western mind that didn't live in those times. We don't know what it was like to go into the Colosseum wrapped in an animal skin and be killed by wild beasts because you confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. We don't know what it was like that there was over 5,000 crucified crosses on the roads of Rome, as Fox's Book of Martyrs will tell you if you'll read it. And the martyrs that have gone from century to century, millennium to millennium, they thought they were going through the tribulation. So where do we think in 21st century America that we're just going to beam me up, Scotty, and it's all okay? See, can you see that maybe this could be a little dangerous? Let's believe for the best, but let's prepare for the worst. And that way we will be ready rapture and not be fooled by the signs of the times. Is that all right? The system of interpretation has its beginnings in 1830. It's based on Daniel chapter 9, verses 1 through 27, where Daniel is shown that there are 70 weeks. 1 week is 7 years. 69 weeks have been fulfilled. 1 week, 7 years, is left. This is seen as 483 years to the killing of Messiah, and they're right. But there is a parenthesis between the 69th week and the 70th week, and that's called the time of the Gentiles, where the Jews are not participating as the church and the Gentiles are. But God has a plan for the Jews, and we'll be raptured out of here, and the Jews will now take over where we have left off, because we're not here, and 144,000 will evangelize the earth. They will rebuild the temple on the Temple Mount. They will offer up sacrifices again because of Ezekiel, and it gets into this whole big theology. Now listen, I've been to Jerusalem. I've been to Israel. I was there in July. God's doing something with the Jewish people. There is no doubt about it. And there are born-again Jews. There was 15 something like 29 of them in 1948 when they started Israel again after 2,000 years of no Israel. Come on, God's doing something. Now there's 15,000. And the born-again messianic movement in Israel is phenomenal. And there's no doubt, as I wrestled with the Holy Spirit on my strong opinions, that God is using Israel to evangelize Israel. And Israel is the friend of God, the apple of God's eye. They are the anointed olive branch. We are the wild olive branch that's been grafted in, and they are going to see their king. They're going to come into the kingdom of God, and the world will be saved. There is no doubt there is a program going on for Israel, and this church wants to be a part of it. No doubt about it. But does that mean we're not here? I don't know. So let's look at another view of another view. The tribulation period that I'm going to look at tonight with you on rapture is viewed not exclusively as a seven-year period ending in the return of Jesus Christ, but rather an age-long beginning with the birth of the church and culminating in a climatic outpouring of God's wrath on a doomed, decaying, and defiant world. The Great Tribulation pertains to this time of great distress and trouble. Now, I want to put up a picture, if I could. All right. Chapter 1, we see John on Patmos. The person is Jesus, the perspective, I'm coming quickly. So this is 2,000 years ago. A day to God is like a 1,000 years, and a 1,000 years is like a day. So in heaven, it may be just be 2 days, quickly. The purpose, right to the church. Chapter 2 and 3, Jesus tending the flame of his church. He is writing those letters and talking to his pastors about the condition of the church. Chapter 4, John is in the spirit in heaven, and John has stepped out of time, and he's seen from an eternal perspective. Now, here's where we mess up. Do you have a piece of paper? Get a piece of paper out. Make it plain if you can. And just draw a little tiny line in the middle of that paper. Or just imagine it if you don't have paper. Just a little line, just a little tiny line. That little tiny line represents time. We live in time. God lives all the rest of that paper. Let's say that is endless and it's eternity. God knows the end from the beginning because we are in time and he's in eternity. God is not controlled by time. God made time. John now is out of time. He has stepped out and he's in the spirit and he is seeing these things. And now the spirit calls him up. And he goes to the throne of God. And there he sees visions and pictures at the throne room. Now, here's the thing. We are going to see another view of another view. Could it be that because we live in time, we do a linear timeline? But you see, when you live in eternity, there is no time. And time can wrap. And time can intersect. And time can cross over it. And time can pile on itself. Are you hearing what I'm saying? What if this thing wasn't linear? What if it was one on top of another, on top of another? Some of them happening at the same time. Some of them culminating and being cumulative. Do you know what I'm saying? Because in everything that we're going to see tonight, there are some things that are the same. Now, we look at this, and John has stepped out of eternity. Now, we see in Revelation chapter 4, let's go to the throne. Let's see what's happening, because this is pretty amazing. So John has seen Jesus, and now he's at the throne of God, and there's an unveiling. After these things, I looked, and behold, the door standing open in heaven, and the first voice, which I heard, was like a trumpet, speaking to me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. He goes on to describe the throne. Then we look at chapter 5. And now we're going to see something that's happened. Now he sees the seraphim, he sees God Almighty, he sees the throne, and he sees the 24 elders, and he sees the crystal sea, and he sees this amazing, radiant rainbow of emeralds over the throne of God. He's seen the most holy, he's seen the eternal, and now he says something else. And this is all about something called the scroll, because this will unlock revelation for you. Watch what happens. Revelation chapter 5, and I'm going to read about 14 verses, so follow with me. And I saw on the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written inside and on the back, sealed with seven seals. Then I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose its seals? And no one in heaven or on the earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. So I wept much because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll or to look at it. What is the scroll? Nobody could even look at it, yet alone open it. But one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals." And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elder stood a lamb as though it had been slain. In the Greek, that is with the fresh marks of slaughter on it. Having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Then he came and he took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat on the throne. So here is the scene. John is seeing this amazing scene, and he's weeping because the Almighty has a scroll in his hand and no one can even look at it. And yet here is this lamb. Now remember, Revelation has a lot of symbols. If you saw something you had never seen in the first century, how would you describe it to your people? He's in a three-dimensional world, and suddenly now he's in the dimension of eternity. So he's writing sequentially what he has seen and chronologically what time or when he has seen it, but it doesn't mean, as all prophecy is like this, that it's going to happen sequentially, one right after another. And by the way, prophecy can be absolutely interpreted symbolically. For instance, James, the pastor of the Jerusalem church, when they were trying to figure out what to do with the Gentiles, takes a prophecy of David rebuilding the tabernacle of David, and he equates it to the Gentile church. Now, how did he go from the tabernacle of David to the Gentile church? And yet that's the interpretation, and that's the correct interpretation of that prophecy. What I'm trying to say to you is when we look at these things and we try to figure them out in time, or we try to figure them out three-dimensionally, we can miss it. Are you with me? So John is seeing this, and he sees the Lamb of God. Now, what is the scroll? I'm going to call this scroll the title deed of the earth. Who has overcome to rule this planet? Because what we're going to see in the book of Revelation is that this thing is much bigger than we've seen before. When Jesus Christ took his blood, he did not take his blood. He spilled it on the earth, but he took it to the throne of God, into the temple of God, into the ark of God, the ark of the covenant. And you see that ark in the book of Revelation. Original sin did not happen on earth. It happened in heaven. And there was a cherub, his name was Lucifer, and he fell, and he wanted to be like God, apart from God. He said, "I'll be like the Most High, apart from the Most High. I will ascend my throne to the uttermost sides of the north." And he was cast out, and he took a rebellion with him, and it went from good to evil. And now all of a sudden, God's heaven and his temple has been polluted, and there was a necessity to put the blood in the highest place of the universe, the temple. Are you with me? So here we see this amazing God, eternal God. He's got the title deed of earth in his hand. It's a scroll. It's written on the front. It's written on the back. It's got seven seals. Now, there's no one that is worthy to take it and open it, but one is, and his name is Jesus. He's seen as the Lamb of God, and he takes that scroll, and he begins to unlock the seals. So what is the scroll? I believe it's the scroll that says who has the authority, who has overcome to rule, who is going to rule the hearts and the souls and the minds of men. There's a man seated at the right hand of the Father, not a fallen angel, a man. Who are you? Who are you that God would use you and use me, temples of dust, to reconcile all things back to himself, visible and invisible, according to Ephesians 1:9 and 1:10. So the scroll holds the contents of rule and authority, judgments and sentences that will provide the ultimate reconciling of a fallen creation back to God. The Lamb is a central person in Revelation 4 and 5. He represents man, God incarnated, who came as a son of man, the son of God, to redeem, reconcile, and restore fallen mankind. Hence, it is the title deed to the earth because this is what's going to happen on the planet. Are you with me? The historical view is what we're going to look at. The scroll is opened by the Lamb. The releasing of the seals begins a series of events and judgments that are designed to break the power of evil and release God's righteousness on the earth. These events and judgments are seen in three sets of seven. Now, can I have that picture of the seven? There we go. There are seven seals. The seventh seal on that scroll. Think of a wax seal. Are you with me? He begins to break open these seals, and he begins to unroll the scroll. These seven seals do something. Now, Jesus said that there will be wars and rumors of wars. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famine. There will be pestilence. There will be disease. I believe that historically, looking at this, these seals could be age-long. And he begins to open them up. Now, I know you've been taught that this is the beginning of the tribulation and that the first seal that's opened comes the first rider who's on a white horse. But what if that white horse isn't the Antichrist? What if it's Jesus and the church going forth to conquer and to enforce the victory that he has at Calvary? And it begins the church age. What a thought. Just a thought. Not saying it's right. But I want us to get past just the dispensational theory that we're taught because there's holes in it. So let's say the second horse is the red horse, the black horse, the pale horse. The fifth seal is the martyrs. The sixth seal is an earthquake, a cataclysmic earthquake. Now here's what I want you to see. What if these seals, now there's seven seals, the seventh seal, see it, number seven, it's going to open something. Going to open the seven trumpets. Now, there are seven trumpets. I believe these are demonic judgments on the earth. I believe they could be age-long and increasing, culminating in intensity as the environment and as things just begin to fall apart on this planet. And we could be at the very time where we're seeing these things starting to happen. Global warming is a reality. There is going to be a fire that will consume the earth. The earth will be scorched in the bowls of wrath. This is real. These are demons coming up out of the pit. I know you've been taught that they're the army, the 2 million man army, but if you read it and look at the trumpets, they are demon beings. The seventh seal opens the seven trumpets. These seven trumpets do something. They bring forth the judgments, more judgments, culminating and intensifying on this planet. The seventh trumpet opens the seven bowls of God's wrath. And those bowls of God's wrath destroy almost all of the earth and mankind. And if Jesus did not shorten the days, there would be no flesh alive. Seven seals. The seventh seal. The sixth seal is a cataclysmic earthquake. There is a cataclysmic earthquake in the trumpet, the seventh trumpet. And there is a cataclysmic earthquake in the seventh bowl of wrath. What if these things are lined up? Do you see what I'm saying? The bowls of wrath lined up with the seventh trumpet, and the seventh trumpet lined up with the sixth seal, which is the earthquake. What if they're piling on each other, intersecting and interloping, because we're in time, but God's not? So what has this got to do with us? Well, what in the world are you saying? Woman, you are crazy. I want to stretch our minds. I don't want us just to buy into stuff. Listen, dispensationalism may be right spot on, but if it's not, I want to be wise to what's going on in the earth. I want to know what's going on. I don't want to run away in fear. I want to stand up and be the body of Christ and have the anointing of God in my life and walk in faith and not fear and see what we can do and how God can use us in these end times. Because there's a harvest that has to come into this planet. This is about the souls of men and women. Who is going to rule the hearts of men and women? Is it going to be Lucifer, that fallen cherubim, Or is it going to be Jesus Christ, all God and all man, the ruling and the reigning King of kings and Lord of lords? And he happens to have combined himself and joined himself to you and I. He's the head, we're the body. We are the church of the living God. He is not separated from us. He loves us, he is with us, and he will be with us. But he needs a church that'll be alive and awake and not full of foolishness and speculation, but doing what God's told us to do, which is to stand and do what God's called us to do under the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit. Because there's a world to win for Jesus Christ. Because you and I are in our last days. We're not coming back here. And I'm closer to my last day than you are. I'm 65. I'm a lot closer than I was at 35. Now listen, can I get that back just for a moment? So here we see the historical view sees Jesus Christ and the church on that white horse. And it's breaking open the church age. And that the seals are age long. They cover and they overlap with the last seal, which is seal number 7, which opens the 7 trumpets. The 7 trumpets accumulate. They grow in intensity. And that last trumpet now is blown and it opens the 7 bowls of God's wrath. The seals are viewed as age-long, increasing in frequency and intensity as the end of the age draws near. These seals are viewed as a panorama of the conflict engaged between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness. As the kingdom of God advances with the gospel, there will be casualties in the fight against evil. There will be martyrs. That fifth seal is martyrs under the throne of God asking, when will we have judgment and justice? And God says, be at peace. Wait till the rest of the martyrs have come in. So there's more martyrs coming. The 7th seal opens the 7 trumpets. The 7 trumpets are the discerning of the spiritual war between that Satan wages, which brings ruin to creation and destroys life. Listen, this planet is under the rule and the guardianship of a fallen renegade angel that is now Satan. The systems of this world are going to be judged. This world is on a downward spiral. It's not going to work out. The governments are not going to work out. There is not going to be answers to problems. We're not going to evolve into higher beings without God and apart from Jesus Christ. It's not going to happen. There is judgment coming to this planet. But before the day of the Lord, the day of his wrath, the bowls of wrath, there is unbelievable mercy and grace and a church on fire and passionate, doing what Pastor Luke preached today, being and becoming like Jesus, walking like Jesus, believing for the supernatural, preaching the gospel, going where it's dangerous to go and doing what isn't popular to do, not caring about our comfort, but caring about the King and what the King wants. You see, I think we fall asleep when we think we're going to get raptured out of here. Beam me up, Scotty. What if it's going to get hot around here? What are we going to do, Rock? Are we going to run in fear? Are we going to stand up and become what we're supposed to be? Brave, full of faith, not afraid, willing to do what the King commands because he's going to need us on spot and ready. Just a suggestion. We've seen the 7 bowls, or the 7 trumpets. The 7 trumpets open the 7 bowls of God's wrath. And the final outpouring of God's wrath and judgment comes upon this earth. And there is very little life left. And if you'll read the book of Revelation, you'll find out that men shake their fist at God and will not repent of their idolatries, of their adulteries, of their sorceries, and of their hatred. The heart is so opposed to God that even when judgment falls, people are not born from that judgment into the kingdom of God. Now, in all of this, there's the Antichrist, the 2 witnesses, 144,000. All of that, we're not going to go into tonight. I wanted you to see just the outline. 7 seals, 7 trumpets, 7 bowls. Each one has a cataclysmic earthquake. Is it different earthquakes, or could it be all the same one? And they're happening, intersecting at the same time. What a thought. We're in time. God's not. So, what has this got to do with the rapture? I've got 5 minutes to close this up, and I'm going to. Well, I don't know. when we're going to get raptured. Let's look at the word rapture. What does it mean? Harpazo. Look at your neighbor and say harpazo. There, you can speak Greek. The word rapture is not in the Bible. It is found in this verse. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. Let's look at it. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep, those who have died. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to be with the Lord. The word caught is the word harpazo. It's found in Jude 1:23, where we are told to pull out those who are in the very, very flames of hell, not even just pulling them out, catching them and snatching them away before they're burned up, saving them. It's found in Acts chapter 8, verse 39, when Philip is ministering to the eunuch from Ethiopia and he baptizes him. And as he baptizes him and they come up out of that water, the Spirit catches Philip away. And the eunuch goes on to Ethiopia praising God because he's just gotten saved. But Philip has been translated. He has been raptured. He's been caught up and he's gone. So the word rapture means to catch, to pull, to snatch away. Now, Paul writes us in 1 Corinthians. Let me read this to you. 15:51-54. Let me read this to you. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. No, that's not a little saying that we put in the church nursery. It's actually in the Word of God. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, a nanosecond, your eye twinkles. It's not even a blink, it's a twinkle. That's how fast this is going to be. At the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. At the last trumpet, Paul writes, there's going to be, for those believers on the earth, in the twinkling of an eye, there's going to be a catching away. You won't even be able to know it. It's just going to happen so fast. You're going to be out of here with Jesus. And so shall you ever be with the Lord. You will not taste death. Like Elijah, he was translated. Now, Paul says that at the sound of the last trumpet, did he say that? Thessalonians talks about the trumpet will sound. Now, I find that there's trumpets in Revelation, right? And there's a last trumpet in Revelation. Can I have that back? Just a thought. Can I have that little? Oh, look, there's that seventh trumpet. That seventh trumpet in the sounding of the days of the seventh trumpet, it says in Revelation. Days. Listen, we're in time. God isn't. Careful about putting everything in little periods and hours, because God's in eternity. At the sounding of that last trumpet, a lot of things happen in heaven. There is silence. The temple of God is opened up. You see the Ark of the Covenant, and seven angels with seven bowls of God's wrath come out. Now listen, this I know for sure. Dispensationalism, it may be spot on. I am not saying not to believe it. I'm saying check it out. But this I know. I know that you and I are not appointed to the wrath of God. I know that. Let me read you some scriptures. So if there are seven seals and seven trumpets and seven bowls of God's wrath, and if the rapture happens just like that, maybe I'm not going to get out of here right at the beginning of a mess, but I know I'm going to get out of here before the wrath of God hits. Because, let me read you this, we are not appointed to God's wrath. Can I have the age-long concept of tribulation? We'll end with this. 1 Thessalonians 5:9. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you have Romans 5:9 up there? Do you have that scripture? It's all right. Romans 5:9 tells us that we are not appointed to the wrath of God. There are bowls of wrath. You're not going to be here for that. Neither am I. Whether God has to hide me away someplace if I'm alive, and some people are pre, some people are mid, and some people are post-rapture. I don't know. I just know this, and I can only tell you what I know. I have scripture that we're not appointed to the wrath of God. I do not have scripture that says I won't have trouble. There's trouble right now. There's people being killed right now for the faith. But I have scripture that when God pours his wrath out, I will not face it. Period. Period. I'm not appointed to the wrath of God. Paul said, the last trumpet, we just read that. There is a last trumpet in Revelation. We just went through that. So looking at this then, last trumpet, not appointed to the wrath of God. I don't know, God, is it all stacking up? Is it interloping and intersecting like the earthquake? Is it all one earthquake, or is it dispensationalism, right? You see, I struggle with this. I've studied this for years. And that's why I'm telling you, I can only tell you what I know. Don't just buy into every theory that you hear. Study the Word of God. Let the revelation of Jesus Christ come forth out of the book of Revelation. Always, because it's a picture of him. And the church as his bride. We come back with him. We evangelize. He anoints us. He shrouds us with the Holy Spirit. He engulfs us in power. We are the church. We're his body. He's the head. The body's not disconnected from the head. It's joined together. He does nothing on the earth apart from you and I, because we are his hands and his feet and his arms and his eyes and his heartbeat on this planet. We're the church. The ecclesia, the elect of God. He said, because of the elect's sake, if those days were not shortened, there's a church here. Whether it's a Jewish church or a Gentile and Jewish church, there's a whole other thing about the two witnesses I don't want to even go touch. But listen, what manner of people ought we to be then? I'm winding it up. Number one, remember who we are. Let's remember who we are through all of this. Sons and saints. Sons and saints. Citizens of heaven. Ephesians 1, 21 and 23 in the Message Bible says, he is in charge of it all, has the final word on everything. At the center of all this, Christ rules the church. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world, but the world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body in which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything. Everything with his presence. Listen, peripheral means at the edge. The world and the church. We can feel, Satan can make us feel like we're on the outside looking in. But you see, the world is on the outside looking in to Jesus and the church. He holds the scroll. He's overcome. He is the king. And he belongs to you, and you, my darlings, belong to him. Remember who you are, sons and saints, citizens of heaven. Number two, what should we do? Keep ourselves pure, holy. 2 Peter 3:13 through 14 says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for the new heavens and the new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot and blameless. They were looking to the end, not being raptured out of here. They knew there was a rapture, but they thought it was at the end. And they said, be pure, be spotless, be blameless. In other words, we are the temple of God. There's so much talk about the temple, but Jesus said, destroy this temple and in 3 days I'll raise it back up. He was talking about his body. The body of Christ is the temple of God, the temple of the Holy Spirit. Maybe we've got this thing all messed up a little bit here. I don't know, but we are his temple, so I better keep it clean, and I better keep it pure. And number three, let his love keep us. I don't need to be afraid of anything. I can be at peace. Every time there's a calamity that's being talked about, every time there's some bad news coming on the scene, my heart is not to be afraid. It's not to fear. It is to stand up and look up and know that my redemption is drawing nigh, because this is what he says in Romans 8:32. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? Is it God? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God and who makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Gee, those sure sound like the seven seals to me. As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. This sounds very, very, very eschatological to me. Paul's talking about the end times. They thought they were living in them. Nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. We are loved by heaven. As Daniel was beloved of God, you are loved by God beyond anything you can even imagine. You are greatly beloved. He's paid the highest price for you. He doesn't want us afraid. He doesn't want us distracted. He doesn't want us off trying to figure out systems. I don't know what the systems are. I confess to you, I have no idea. I know this. The generation that lives it will understand it. If that's us, it's going to come clear faster and faster and faster. If it's not us, then we're going to be with the Father and we're going to join him and come back and be with the group that's going to get raptured out of here and we're going to see it. So it's win-win anyway. You've been so good. I've gone way too long. I know this was a lot tonight, and I know this was a lot of thinking in a different way, another view of another view. But the rapture's real. It's coming. We're ready for it. When is it coming? I don't know. Pre, post, mid, I don't know. Let's be ready, Rapture Church. Let's be ready to meet him, keeping ourselves in the love of God, keeping our hearts pure as we are the temple of God, and remembering that we are sons and saints doing his bidding, his body, on the earth. And before we leave tonight, I just need to talk to you for just a moment because personally, I don't know, I can't even see your lovely faces. I don't have my glasses on. I would imagine most of you in here are right with God. There's not a lot of us in this room tonight, but I need to find out because what would I do when I stand before God and he said to me, Deb, you didn't invite anybody to come and meet me. And that's what we're here for. We're here to teach the word of God, but we're also here to tell you about this amazing Savior. This planet is on a collision course with destiny. There is no doubt about it. You and I were born into sin. You had no choice. I had no choice. I was born with a blood disease called sin. I couldn't be good enough for God. I never could. There was no way I could get to God. Even though in this life, I'm told and taught that if I'm just a good little girl, if I'm just a nice old lady, if I just do good things, why, I'll get to heaven. But you see, God never said that. He said your goodness, your humanity, and your best, the best of you is like a filthy rag in comparison to my goodness. And heaven is God's throne, and it's God's home. And he sets the rules. And he knew that you and I couldn't get to him. So he came to us. And he walked through this human experience. All God and all man. He died on that cross. And Jesus said, if you'll look at that cross, and if you'll believe that I am who I said I am, the Son of God, the Son of Man, that I died for you, for your sins. When I couldn't fix me, when I couldn't make things right, when I'd screwed up and I had nowhere to go, I looked at that cross and I realized that at that cross there was forgiveness. At that cross there was new life. And at that cross there was the Son of God who was real and exactly who he said he was. And I had to humble myself and realize that I needed a Savior and he was it. And invite him into my heart and into my life. When I did that, I got born again. I gave him permission to come into my life and be my Savior and my Lord. Lord means boss. If you've never invited him to be the Savior and the Lord of your life, then you're here tonight by divine appointment. This is real. You've listened to this older woman. Who knows, I was huffing and puffing, sweating a little bit. I always get so embarrassed that I do that. There's a foolishness of preaching, but forget me. I'm here to invite you. What have you done with Jesus? Where are you at with him? What if these are your last days? You don't have tomorrow, but you've got tonight. Our life is a vapor and it's so short. Is he Savior and Lord of your life? Because if he's not, right now I want to give you the opportunity to get right with God and to invite him into your heart, and we'll pray with you. So I'm just going to give you the gift of a moment of intimacy. So just, we don't normally do this, but just close your eyes and bow your heads. Because I want to ask you, where are you at with him? Have you been in and out, up and down? Do you need to get right with God? Have you said to yourself, I know this is true, but I just don't trust myself. I know me, and I'm going to just screw up again. No, he never told you to trust you, but he said you can trust him. And when you say, this is it, Lord, help me, he'll come in and change you from the inside out like he did me. So you don't have to be afraid of you. He can fix you, but you can't. So all over this auditorium, if you've been running from him instead of to him, I'm talking to you. If you've backslidden and you knew you should get right with God, I'm talking to you. If you've never said, Lord, be my Savior, be my Lord, I'm talking to you. So I'm just going to ask, count to three, just raise your hands quickly. One, two, three, if you need to get right with God, let's just lift your hands up. Ready? One, two, three. Who needs to get right with God? Just lift your hand and let me see it. I see that hand. Lift them high and wave them at me. Let me see them. Anybody else? One hand, that's it? Anybody in the, there's another hand. I see that hand. Anybody else need to get right with God tonight? I see that hand. All right, let's do this. Because of the time and because this preacher went too long, I want you to stand with me. And if you raised your hand, I want you to get your stuff and come and meet me right here in this aisle. I gave you a moment of privacy with God. Now, he said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. If you can't walk down an aisle to meet Jesus, how can you walk out those doors and serve him? So just get up here. And some of you didn't raise your hands, but you should have. And you know you need to get right with God. So just come on up quickly. Let's do this quickly. Just quickly. Jesus, I can't make you come, but I'm inviting you to come and get right with God. He is who he says he is. He loves you. He's not mad at you, but he's the only one that can fix you.
You're the reason that I live. You're the reason that I breathe.
If you raised your hand, you need to get down here. If you didn't raise your hand and you know you should have, you need to get down here. He wants to change your life. But he will not force himself on you. You've got to invite him and ask him and believe. You don't have to figure it out. You just have to believe in your heart. This is real. More real than you know. Anybody else? They're still coming. Quickly come. Quickly come. Come on. Let's get right with God tonight. This is why we're here. He wants to change our lives, but he will not share us with anybody else. Lord means boss. Father, thank you for these precious ones. Now look, smile at me. Aren't you darling? Look at you. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday party. It's yours. So this is Pastor Joelle. We're going to pray with you. We're going to do that privately. So we're just going to ask you to turn this way. Which way is this? That's left. I'm a little directionally impaired, and follow Pastor Joelle. We're going to pray and give you some stuff.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.